morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
You know, there just seems to be no end to the twists and the turns of the trail that we ride. And when the adventures are over, they come back to life in the retelling of the story. Sometimes hilarious and sometimes pretty scary, but always colorful. And this week, you'll hear from a cowboy and a good singer who has a lot of great adventure.
All of a sudden, he reached over, cuffed me in the back of the head, knocked my hat off. Whoa, what'd I do, Dad?
Well, that's Michael Hurwitz, and you'll find out why his dad cuffed him and knocked his hat off in just a little while here. And we'll dig way down into the vault for a story from a bronc riding legend and a great musician, George Myron.
He would drive about 30 minutes, pretend he was tired, and get one of them kids, and he'd sleep in the back seat all night.
George Myron from the vault in a story about going down the rodeo road with Casey Tibbs. And on the Rangeland News, a few things I sure wasn't aware of.
There are things many of us can do to delay, reduce, or even help prevent the effects of Alzheimer's and dementia.
And my old pal, Andy Nelson, will be in the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight.
Often overlooked by most folks, except for real working cowboys.
On the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, the consequences of not knowing the limitations of your horse. And you'll hear that great story from Mike Hurwitz after a legend in Western music, Luke Reed, starts things off.
He rode north out of Texas to an uncharted land, looking for a place to make his way. With a saddle and a bedroll and a dream in his mind, he started a legend still living today. With a hat made by Stetson, spurs and high-heeled boots, through the years not that much has changed. He never meant to be a hero, it just turned out that way. He's still around and cowboy is his name. He's what all the little fellas want to grow up to be, and what women think they can domesticate. He's at home on a range and alone in a crowd. Feels he's born 100 years too late. What he does, doesn't do for fortune or for fame. It's a way of life, 'cause cowboy is his name. He's been wrote about in poetry, sung about in song, talked about in Houston and Cheyenne. You might see him at the stockyards or the local rodeo, but most days he's out making a hand. He doesn't measure worth in money or a fancy house in town. He's happy with his life out on the plains. He's a friend you can depend on in the snow and sleet and rain. He takes pride in knowing cowboy is his name. He's what all the little fellas want to grow up to be, what the women think they can domesticate. He's at home on a range and alone in the crowd. Feels he's born 100 years too late. What he doesn't do for fortune or for fame. It's a way of life, 'cause cowboy is his name. He's still out there somewhere, riding on the range. He's proud to know the cowboy is his name.
Mike Hurwitz travels the country with his unique blend of Western swing and Mississippi blues these days, but he was ranch-raised and cowboyed all over Wyoming for outfits big and small. And we got to talking about the cowboy code of respect, and he shared this story.
My dad and I were trailing some cows one time, moving them to a different range, and we had just a few head with us, and we 20 head or so, and we were headed through a little town called Centennial and stopped off at parked the cows out of town and stopped off to have a bite to eat and a beer. I was maybe 15, 16 years old, and we got off, tied up our horses outside this little Nelson's grocery and cafe, and went in, and I noticed my dad took his spurs off and hung them over his saddle when we walked in, and I paid no attention, and I walked in and sat down at the counter there, and I was ordered a beer, and my dad did, and all of a sudden he reached over and cuffed me in the back of the head, knocked my hat off. I was like, whoa, what'd I do, Dad? He goes, don't you ever let me see you wear a spurs inside a restaurant or public place again. That is the worst manners that anyone could possibly have. And ever since then, if I see somebody with spurs on in a room, it always makes me kind of shiver, you know. I know I spent some time in Aspen, Colorado for a while. My sister was living down there, and she grabbed me, and when I first got down there, said, come on downtown, Mike, we got to check this out. And there was this Aspen Cowboy Bar down there with all these dude wranglers from the T-Lazy 7 up the hill, and they were all down there wearing their chaps and their spurs and dancing with these gals and tearing up the dance floor, and it was, me and my sister sat there and laughed for a long time.
How can you tell the deal from the wannabes?
Yeah, that's, well, one thing, they're not, the real deals ain't wearing their spurs in the restaurants and bars, going dancing with their spurs on.
No, or even dancing with their hats on.
No.
Mike and I will talk more about the cowboy traditions of respect and about what's been happening on some of those big Wyoming ranches. And you'll hear one of his original songs when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. We're talking with Mike Hurwitz today about cowboys, horses, and the cowboy code, that tradition of respect.
Well, there's so many of those just respectful things that go back to our cowboy traditions. And I heard that for a long time. I mean, that is just the worst possible manners, is to wear your spurs inside the house or sit down and eat with your hat on. I mean, I guess we're drifting away from that now. But
well, my dad, you know, until he was in his 80s, he would still, if I'd sit down at the table with a ball cap on or a hat or a cowboy hat on, he'd reach over and flick it off my head every time. He says, keep your damn hat off, Mike, the table.
Yeah.
And, you know, you forget about that because it has kind of become accepted now to wear a hat. Men that wear hats wear them all the time, you know. But in those, you know, where my dad grew up, that was just like, you do not wear a hat in the house, especially at the table.
That's right, yeah. And there's so many things, you know. A lady comes in and you stand up. And until she's seated, you sit down. Things like that.
Open a door. You know, it's always funny. You meet, you go someplace and you're playing in some city, and you're out to a restaurant or something, and a woman's walking down the street into the place, and you hold the door open and wait for her, and they're always shocked. They're going, well, thank you. Nobody's done that for me for a long time.
Oh, Wyoming has still got some pretty big outfits, I guess, and there's still some things that are done traditionally.
Yeah, there's still some ranching. You know, it's dying off. Places like Jackson Hole that are, you know, resort communities, ranchers, they end up selling their, a lot of people are selling family ranches off because, I mean, you can get, you know, $1 million an acre. It's pretty hard to justify it. You got to be sitting good enough where you don't even have to think about selling it off to not start considering it.
Yeah.
Now, I told you you'd hear Mike sing today, and as I closed my eyes and listened to the smoky quality of his voice, it really brought his unique and original songs to life. Similar in a way, I think, maybe to Bobby Bear's voice, and yet different. Anyhow, here's one from his CD, Cowboy Fandango.
out on the plains of southeast Wyoming, where the Elk Mountain Ridge climbs right up to the stars. There's a young cowgirl down in a meadow. She dreams about leaving, but ain't done it so far. Her great-granddaddy came to the prairie from Scotland, carved out a home in a hard new land. His cattle were fat, he's doing all right. His sons grew up wild and they rode for the brand. Saturday rolls around, all the boys would go down to the Garden Spot Pavilion to have a little fun. Smoke filled the air, and all the ranch girls is there. It's a cowboy fandango with the son of a gun. Ernie Tubb was there, singing lonesome and blue. You could dance and you could fight, it's all up to you. She doctors a little calf, shakes off a rope. He runs off and stands there, twitching his ears. She works on the range, right along with her brothers, like her family has done for so damn many years. That night after supper, as she washes the dishes, looks out the window with a tear in her eye. The new dress she bought's hanging up in the closet. She ain't wore it yet, and her life's slipping by. Saturday rolls around, they'd all go into town to the Garden Spot Pavilion to dance and drink beer. And the boy from down the hill said, "Hey there, McGill, you sure are looking good. I'm glad that you're here." And they danced all night long on that old springy floor, but the shades of the others have been there before. Traveling band stopped in one night on the way down the road. I spent all my breaks with this old bartender. She'd been there for years and oh, the story she told. Saturday rolls around, the whole valley'd go down. The girls all were pretty in the bar room's dim light. T. Texas Tyler looked down from a poster in the room behind the stage where I kissed her that night. And I signed my name there next to his on the door, with all of them rounders and pickers and more. Tommy Dorsey was there, Bob Wills came up too. It's a short ride from Hannah where the UP come through. And they danced all night long that old springy floor at the Garden Spot Pavilion since 1904.
Neat song there called The Garden Spot Pavilion from this week's guest, Mike Hurwitz.
So did you wind up riding for other outfits then after you left home?
Oh, yeah. In fact, my dad kind of got out of the business by the time, you know, I was in my late teens. He was a geologist also, and he was more of a hobby rancher that was just carrying on the tradition from our family. But I worked for every outfit within, you know, a couple hundred miles over the years when I was younger, and met a lot of great old boys. And I used to break horses for when I was 16 years old. I remember I was working for the 91 ranch then, and these they brought in the boss, old Carl Schakel, brought in a a semi full of Mexican Mustangs that were supposed to be green broke. And me and this other kid, our job was to smooth them out into usable ponies for the string. And those horses had never been touched by anybody. So our job for that whole summer was busting out them horses. And there were a bunch of old hands, that a couple old guys, one old guy, Henry, that worked on that ranch that had been there for 40 years or more, and was an old bronc buster, taught me a lot of tricks. He used to sit around and watch while we was in the round corral bucking them out, and just stand back there and lean on the post, and then I'd get up off or get thrown off, and he'd come over and say, you know what, you ought to try there, buddy.
I imagine they fired pretty good, some of them. Like, did you have any time to do much groundwork with them before you had the saddle?
No, we were just rough breaking them. We'd get on them horses and just let them rip, you know.
So did you hit the ground a few times?
More than a few. And then I kept up with it, and over the years broke horses and trained horses for other people up into when I was in my 40s. And then it started realizing this is hurting a lot more than it used to. Yeah. It takes more than a day or two to feel good again.
Yeah, it can do. Yeah. So, how many would you be working on at a time when you're doing that? Like, how many could you take on, say, in a day? I know when I was.
Where do you usually work? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
I was just going to say, when I was taking colts in for the public, I found that, boy, if I had any more than six or seven, that's about all I could get to in a day.
Well, when you're 16 years old and, you know, 16, 17 years old, you can go through 10, 15 horses a day and until you take the buck out of them, and then or you don't, whichever happens first. You know, you got to always, the old adage, you know, get back on until they quiet down. That was kind of what we tried doing, but a lot of times you get them quieted down one day, and the next day you get back on them, and it's like you never did anything with them.
Isn't that, right. Oh, he's not going to buck anymore.
Yeah, right.
It's funny how the older we get, the more aware of that we are. And then, like you say, when you're 16 or 17 years old, you didn't really care what they did. You were, you know,
it's
figured you rode with that attitude, and I think the horses picked that up in a way, too. But now that we get way beyond that point, and we feel this colt tense up, and we kind of feel that tail is clamped down, and we know
start
that, you just, oh boy, then all of a sudden you want to diffuse that right away.
Yeah, well, you're hanging on tight as soon as you start feeling them bunch up like that. Yeah.
Whereas before, you just sort of, okay, let's see what you got.
Yeah.
Oh, you're going to love this. Butch Falk with an R.W. Hampton song that really shows off Butch's great guitar style. Then the Rangeland News, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
George Myron had a long, successful rodeo career, and now he's the leader and bass player for the Rodeo Wind Band, featuring his wife, Joyce Smith, and some legends of country music.
To be part of the Rodeo Wind Band, you know, I do my little part, and then I join the band and back up these wonderful singers. So it's been wonderful, let's put it that way.
Right.
Yes.
And George, you're a legend in rodeo and chuck wagon and country music and everything, and I imagine you just have a suitcase full of road stories.
Where do you want me to start? I was telling a couple of Casey Tibbs stories a while ago. One of them was he was a great saddle bronc rider, and he'd get some young guys to travel with him. He would drive about 30 minutes, pretend he was tired, and get one of them kids, and he'd sleep in the back seat all night. But Tom Tesher knew about it, and Tom rode with him from Sydney, Iowa to Sydney, Nebraska one time. Casey drove his 30 miles, got sleepy, and Tom started driving. And halfway through Nebraska, the roads are quite flat, the ditches are shallow, and there was a nice big row crops, you know. So he just into the ditch, into the row crops, and that Lincoln was just a bouncing, banging, and back on the road, and Casey reared up and said, "What happened?" He said, "I think I fell asleep." He said, I'll drive. Tom got in the back and slept all the way to Sydney, Montana.
From a radiator cap to an engine block, BZTractorParts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal Deutz Leyland, Landini, Oliver Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com. For a long time, I've enjoyed listening to Butch Falk, both his singing and his unique guitar playing. He builds his own guitars, did you know? And about the middle of this one, you'll get to really hear him pick. It's R.W. Hampton's Dream Riding.
I ride along the lazy trail of dreaming. Sleepy, he's been dozing all the way. Dreaming about a filly in the meadow. Dreaming about my pretty days in May. Dream riding, dreaming my life away. Later in the hot part of the evening, we'll stop a while and lay up in the shade. Folks all passing by will think we're loafing, but I just think we've really got it made. Dream riding, dreaming my life away. Some folks think I'm lazy, my mind's a little hazy. On that I'd almost have to confess. Reality is fine, if you got the time. Dreaming always suited me best. Sometime in the wee hours of the morning, saddle up my dreams and ride away. I'll rope a shooting star, then go to gliding. Drift around until the break of day. Dream riding, dreaming my life away. I'm lazy, my mind's a little hazy. On that I'd almost have to confess. Reality is fine, if you got the time. Dreaming always suited me best. Sometime in the wee hours of the morning, I'll saddle up my dreams and ride away. Hope to shoot and star then go to glide. Drift around until the break of day. Dream riding, dreaming my life away. Dream riding, dreaming my life away.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, just about every one of us, I think, knows someone who has been robbed of their quality of life by one of the cruelest diseases to ever attack humans, and that is Alzheimer's disease. And as far as we know, there's still no cure. But I didn't realize what a huge role our diet can play in preventing it. Here's Gary Crawford.
According to the Centers for Disease Control,
right now, 5.8 million Americans over age 65 live with Alzheimer's disease.
And that number could double by 2050. This from Kansas State University Extension food scientist Karen Blakesley. However, she says there are things many of us can do to delay, reduce, or even help prevent the effects of Alzheimer's and dementia. At Tufts University, researchers followed the diets and medical happenings of almost 3,000 people for 20 years. And the remarkable result?
Those that did consume fruits and vegetables that were high in flavonoid compounds were at least 50% less likely to get dementia or show the signs of it.
Flavonoids are compounds mainly in the dark pigments of foods like peaches, berries, tomatoes, red cabbage, onions, kale, dark green vegetables like broccoli, and also tea, red wine, and dark chocolate. They were already known to help reduce risks of cancer and heart disease. Now we can add Alzheimer's to that list. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
At least two livestock organizations have voiced opposition to a proposed Health Canada measure that would see certain meat products labeled as having too much saturated fat. Proposed amendments for food and drug laws in Canada would introduce front-of-package labels for prepackaged foods deemed to be high in sodium, sugars, and saturated fat. And while some single-ingredient items like eggs, milk, fruits, and vegetables, and meat fish products would receive exemptions from these new labels, and ground beef and pork are not exempt. Now, this kind of regulation is a blow to the beef sector, said Tyler Fulton, president of the Manitoba Beef Producers and that province's rep in the Canadian Cattlemen's Association. He says it feels like we're being kicked while we're down. It makes no sense that products like milk or butter, which are single ingredient products, receive the exemption. It feels like we're being used as a target, even if we're trying to get the story out that beef is great for conservation and environmental outcomes. A potential risk of this food label is having consumers not trust Canadian agriculture. Well, inflation is raising the price on all sorts of items in the grocery stores, as I'm sure you're noticing, but one staple still appears to be immune, and that is those nice-smelling rotisserie chickens. That's not to say that poultry isn't suffering from soaring costs. Chicken prices nationwide have increased 16.4% so far in this year, according to Consumer Price Index, and pointing to the ongoing bird flu outbreak, the U.S. Department of Agriculture products predicts wholesale poultry prices will increase 15 to 18% this year. But stores, including Costco and Walmart and others, have kept their prices of those rotisserie chickens pretty much where they've been. How come? Well, Ernest Baskin is an associate professor of food marketing at St. Joe's University, and he says it's just an example of loss leader pricing, a marketing strategy in which all companies sell certain products below their market cost in order to get you in the store, and sometimes often putting higher priced goods into your basket. Ah, so that's what they're doing. And the community of Rosetown, Saskatchewan is getting a new fertilizer plant. Protein Industries Canada, along with AGT Foods, Luchant, New Wave Research, and Eberhard Ag Solutions are working together on the $19 million project. And this fertilizer facility will use peas, lentils, and oat hulls to create a sustainable, non-polluting, climate-positive micronutrient fertilizer called Soilios. And once operational, the plant will have the capacity to produce about 6,500 tons of fertilizer per year. And it will also create 25 jobs in that community. Oh boy, I should have said this away sooner, but we just had a wonderful time at the Lido Theater in Fort St. John with two sold-out shows for the Western Spirit Band and Tom Cole and Friends. Wonderful hospitality, great audience, and I was talking to some of the folks after the show, and one lady said her son and daughter, both teenagers, said, "Oh, we just loved those three old guys. They were really funny." Well, us three old guys are going to be at the 30th annual Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering, August 12th to 14th. And for all the details, just see stonyplaincowboygathering.com or call 780-718-5379.
The next regular cattle sale at the BC Livestock Co-op Kamloops Yards is July the 19th, and there's another one on August the 9th, and the next one in Williams Lake is August the 11th. Get all the details. Watch the sale streaming live at bclivestock.bc.ca. And out at the Innisfail Auction Market, they, of course, have regular cattle sales and had for so long. Every Wednesday, they start at 9 in the morning. Butcher cows and bulls, followed by all the other classes of cattle. And you can get the details and the market report, the prices, and so much more at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. And you can call Danny, Mark, or Dwayne at 1-800-710-3166. Okay, now the final item. And I actually stole this one from my old pal, longtime radio personality, Jimmy Hughes.
I do know some hard-working cowboys who carry either a New Testament or a pocket-sized Bible in their shirt pockets. And according to Jimmy, one guy accidentally lost his favorite pocket Bible when he got off his horse and spent some time splicing the wires in a broken fence. Now, 3 weeks later, a cow walked up to him, carrying the Bible in her mouth. Well, the cowboy raised his eyes to heaven and he said, "It is a miracle." "Not really," said the cow. "Your name is written on the inside cover."
Coming up is the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear horse training file and some information on the next Spirit of the West cruise when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Just ahead of the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, I wanted to update you on the status of the next Spirit of the West cruise. It's going to be known as the Friends of the Spirit of the West, and it takes place this coming January. Well, that's not that long away. And it'll include the spectacular Panama Canal. Your hosts will be the longtime Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan, with lots of special guests, and it'll follow the same winning format of our last 20 Spirit of the West cruises. Be sure and watch our website, hugh-mcclennan.com, and our cruise Facebook page for more information. And you can always call 1-800-530-0131 and ask about the Friends of the Spirit of the West cruise.
Now it's time for the horse training file, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
At Irvine Tack and Western Wear, you won't find this.
Ah, new duds for the rodeo. Let's see, there's a hat over there, a few belts over yonder, and jeans? I could sell you mine, they're gently used. Yeah, fine, I'll keep them on.
But you will find this.
Rodeo apparel? It's all here. The biggest selection around.
Irvin Tack and Western Wear has something for cowboys, cowgirls, and city folks, too. Western Wear with a welcome twist. Exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield, open 7 days a week.
Canada's largest Western store.
A well-seasoned ranch horse is, as the saying goes, worth his weight in gold. Every day, somewhere in the West, a good old pony probably saves a cowboy or cowgirl's life. There have, however, been lots of broken bones and worse caused by a rider not knowing the limitations of his horse and getting victimized in a high-risk situation. The key to surviving when the cattle are in the canyon bottoms and the heavy timber is to understand what your horse is capable of and knowing when to keep him out of a situation he can't handle. I can recall a lot of situations where I was on a fairly green colt or even a horse that was reasonably well broke but not experienced in some situations. And I'm not too proud to get off and let one of the other guys hold my horse while I go down into the creek bottom on foot to scart the cows out on the trail. When Lucky and I were both a little younger and she was still learning, there were lots of times when she'd be following me as we scrambled through the underbrush trying to follow the cattle, and I'd have gotten off her a while ago and we'd both be on our hands and knees. Now, some horses have a knack for getting safely through the heavy brush, some charge through it like a tank, and some of them get their feet all tangled up and stagger and stumble around. As the years went by, the bond between Lucky and I continues to build, and she's about as good as anything I've seen for handling those rough and rocky situations. There are horses that are just fine in easy country and open trails, but they may never be safe to take into those real challenging heavy brush country areas, and the important thing to know is the difference and how to tell your horse's limitations.
Anvor, Irvin, Saddles, and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. Something else our horses do really well with is a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. And you can find out all about what's in it and why it works so well at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. If you're buying or selling farm machinery, heavy equipment, or trucks, let Progressive Auctions take the hassle out of your sale or your search. There's an online auction every Wednesday at progressiveauctions.ca. Doesn't matter where you live, Progressive Auctions can find the machinery or equipment you need or the buyers who are looking for what you're selling. Progressiveauctions.ca. For more information, call 844-309-9424. The 30th annual Stony Plain Cowboy Gathering happens August 12th to 14th at Emmanuel Lutheran Church, Stony Plain, Alberta. Storytelling, music, and poetry with stars like Tom Cole.
Let me sing you a picture of an Alberta sky.
Doris Daly.
The porch light's on, a fire crackles bright, maybe Ian's singing at the Longview Hall.
Stuart McDougall.
As long as there's a memory of him, the sun ain't going down on sundown swim.
And so many more. For tickets and information, call 780-718-5379 and see StonyPlainCowboyGathering.com.
That's how it goes.
Oh, that'll be like a big reunion. Sure looking forward to that. Having the Western Spirit Band, Uncle Mike, and little brother Jim with me. It's going to be a great time in Stony Plain.
I've taken in the regular sales at the BC Livestock Co-op every chance we get. Sold horses there and bought some there. Actually, that's where Cody came from. And in fact, she is a roan. Sometimes. A bay roan, not a blue roan like the one the guy bought in this song from my guest Mike Hurwitz. Mike, what's the rest of that story?
Now Henry was a cowhand down on the 91. Loved to ride and rope, and he broke some just for fun. One day he spied a little blue roan with spots upon his back. Knew he had to have that horse, and good Lord, that was that. Now he raised his hand so well that it weren't a case of luck. Then the man said, son, you bought a horse, hope you got $900. Henry digs out his robe, and he left there busted flat. But he trailered home that little blue roan with the spots upon his back. Now he pulled up in the yard, about the time they finished chuck. So the boys was hanging out, but Henry stepped out of his truck. Walked around the back real proud, but he ducked a second late. When a hoof shot at him, knocked him flat as he opened up the gate. Henry picked himself up off the ground, and the boys was laughing hard. Back the blue roan out, and he leads him across the yard. Heard a yelp and spun around, but there weren't nothing there. Sis old Cookie's dingo pup went sailing through the air. Now he parked him in a round corral, and he went to get his rig. When he came back from the tack shed, the roan was dancing quite a jig. Poles were scattered everywhere, and the line with the boss's shirts was tied around a blue roan's neck and trailing through the dirt. Now the blue roan, he was stout and quick, and cowy as could be. He could turn on a dime and give you change, suited Henry to a T. If you dropped the reins, he'd stand there still like a good cow pony should. You get to sneaking around behind him, boys, he's bound to nail you good. Rainy morning when he broke old Jack's good leg. Gave the vet a dandy knot that looked like a hard-boiled egg. Clayton parked his truck behind him when he was tied up to a fence. Lost the mirror on his brand new rig and acquired some minor dents. That summer turned to fall, things went from bad to worse. If a Blue Roan's name was spoke at all, it was prefaced with a curse. The boss said, Henry, you're a hell of a hand, you just gotta know. We'd like to have you winter on, but that roan has got to go. Now Henry never was a man for sitting on the fence, so he packed his rig, drew his pay, though it didn't make much sense. Now he's camped up on the muddy, eating beans and bacon fat, his red eyes staring at the little blue roan with the spots upon his back. He'd sell you that horse for a nickel, and he'd never take him back.
Mike Hurwitz and the Little Blue Roan from his CD Cowboy Fandango.
I got a good story, Hugh. There was, may not be very good, but it's true anyway. I was working for this old feller with this this ranch in the Centennial Valley, and there was this old guy I used to ride with that I thought was probably the best cowboy I had ever met. And he was, he wasn't that old. He seemed old to me at the time, but he was in it maybe 60-something. My age now.
That's not old.
And he had one spur. He always rode with one spur, his right spur. And I looked up to him. His name was Al, and I really held a lot of respect for him. A good hand, all around hand, but a hell of a horseman. And I'd been riding with him and watching him. We were on the breeding crew where we'd gather in a bunch of heifers and they were bring them into the pens and they'd get AI'd. So that was our job, get rounding up these cattle out there. And we spent a lot of hours in the saddle every day together. And I was watching him all the time with that one spur, and he knew he worked that spur all the time, was just tickling the horse with it, getting him to do whatever he wanted to do. So I was about 14 then. I took to wearing one spur myself for a while. And one time I asked him, because I thought he was so cool, one time I said, Al, how come you wear just one spur like that? Where'd you learn that trick? And he sits there. I was expecting something profound. He looked over at me and he goes, well, Mike, I'll tell you. I lost the other one about 46 years ago. And that was all he ever said about it.
Man, I got myself a nice set of spurs at the National Cowboy Symposium in Lubbock, Texas, quite a few years ago. And they had first spurs I ever had with jingle bobs on them. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't 3 or 4 days out in our heavy brush country, and I lost the jingle bobs off my spurs. And one of my partners said, well, you're just going to have to ride out there and be real quiet till you hear that jingle bob, and then you'll know where it is. I took a little bit of a ribbon because we, in our bush country, not many guys use those.
Yeah, you don't see them in Wyoming either. Yeah. I'm not. What are they exactly for?
I think it's something in the way of buckaroo traditions where the trappings are worn with a lot of pride, and there's a quite a bit of silver in the bits and the headstalls, and I think it's or even when you're riding, it was kind of neat. It's just your horse is jogging along and you just have that rhythmic little jingle to it, and even in Waddy. Yeah, or Waddy Mitchell's poem, there's some jingle bobs a-ringing and some snaffle bits, the cricket bridles chirping and some jingle bobs.
Kind of down in southeast Wyoming, it was kind of a term of derision that people would say, oh, call somebody a jingle bob.
Yeah, it is not really a term of respect.
And I didn't know what I never knew what they were for years until I saw a pair of Crockett's with some jingle bobs on them.
Well, coming up will be the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight with Andy Nelson and another beautiful song of the West when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. A good poem from our pal Andy Nelson is coming up. And if I was to count up all the wonderful songs written by Ian Tyson
It would probably take me the rest of the year. From the early folk stuff he recorded with Sylvia to his wonderful, insightful songs of cowboys, cattle, and horses. So many of the elements that make this way of life such a wonderful place to be. Ian Tyson and the wonder of it all.
There's this place we're gonna ride, up where the rim rock meets the night. We'll go hand in hand, riding through the purple starlight, and the coyote on the wind sends his lonely lover's call. We'll hold each other close in the wonder of it all. The Golden West has come and gone right before our very eyes, but they will never count the stars, and they will never fence the skies. All I know, I love you, and I won't let you fall. We're rolling down the Milky Way into the wonder of it all. Life gets harder every day, and sometimes it seems the dream almost dies. But love will find a way, it will show us the way to the canyons of the stars and the endless midnight skies. Come on, girl, we're gonna ride where the rim rock meets the night. We'll go hand in hand, riding through the purple starlight, and the coyote on the wind sends his lonely lover's call. We'll hold each other close in the wonder of it all. We'll hold each other close in the wonder.
Well, we got to talking about spurs with Mike Hurwitz earlier today, and he mentioned an old pair of Crockett spurs, and that reminded me of Andy Nelson and this piece of cowboy poetry.
As long as I can remember, the Crockett spurs belonged to Jim. They're modest, yet very complex, and remind me a lot of him. Tempered through hard work and labor, engraved with years of bad weather, forged from the iron of turmoil, thick in the skin and the leather, perfectly balanced in function, dependable when called on to work, precise when applied to the trade, dangerous when used by a jerk. Both may appear harsh at first sight, but are subtle when put into use. The hard edges have worn down some, polished by the years of abuse. Not very flashy to look at, don't make a whole lot of noise, often overlooked by most folks except for real working cowboys. As progress replaces tradition, an emotion within me stirs. My heritage is a priceless gift, like Jim and those old Crockett spurs.
Andy Nelson and Andy and his brother Jim host the long-running syndicated radio show called Clear Out West, and they'll be hosting their 8th annual Cow Cruise, C-O-W, an 11-day journey to the Maritimes and New England. And that's coming up before too long. You can get the details on clearoutwest.com. And thank you so much for making the ride. I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan. And be sure to see the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. You can subscribe online at canadiancowboy.ca.
And be sure to check out our YouTube channel where you can see this show and a whole bunch more from the past with video. And you can download it as a podcast and take it with you. The link's right there on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I am Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.